past several weeks, in fact, ever since Terry left, the passages that we've been focusing on have one common theme. In short, they have in various ways made the statement, our journey as Christians is not about our little plans and designs. It's about God's plan and God's design. In other words, this is not about us. It's about God. We have spent 7 weeks going over the same old ground, repackaging the same message in different forms, from envisioning the church as a deserted building emptied of everything but God's quiet call, to letting go of all our ideas of what success looks like, to trusting in a God who is so much larger than anything we can imagine, and a God who is present in our lives whether we realize it or not. This is not about us. It's about God. Why would we spend so much time on such a simple message? Well, first of all, because it's the foundation of all that we do in church. If we feed the hungry, but we don't extend God's love and hospitality to them, we might as well be a food bank. If we give H-packs to homeless people, but we don't pray for them, we might as well be a social service agency. If we gather for worship every week, but we don't follow Jesus day by day, we might as well be a social club. But when we remember that this is all about God and not about us, we have something of real value to offer the world, something that no one else can bring. Now, the second reason why we would spend so much time on this message is that it's really hard for us to hold on to. Now, I don't mean to suggest that we're dense or slow to comprehend. I know that you are all highly intelligent people. But sometimes, intelligent people are the ones that are most tempted to believe that maybe it's a little bit about them. It can be tempting to feel that we are alone in carrying our heavy burdens. And sometimes we forget that our effectiveness in the world is caused by a multitude of factors beyond our control, which come together seamlessly through a power that's greater than ourselves. And no matter how accomplished we are, no matter how many people we help, or lives we touch, we only contribute a small portion to the whole of life. This is not about us. It's about God. But now, after 7 weeks of sermons about how it's all about God, I want to slowly shift the focus towards where we go from here. Once we are emptied of us and filled with the Spirit, what do? Well, this morning's passage is a great place to begin to answer that question. We can start by noticing how many times the writer of Ephesians uses the word one in the beginning of chapter 4. Did you count? It was 7. 7 references to the unity or oneness of the Spirit of which we are a part. The author is pleading with us to remember, to live in that oneness. So as we're being launched out into the world to live out the calling to which we have been called, as we go from here, we are told that we should, that we must remember that we are part of something greater than ourselves. We are not alone. We are not on our own. Next, we can notice that the words that are being used, humility, gentleness, patience, bearing, and love, These are very descriptive terms. So these qualities are the mark of a person who is fulfilling their calling as a Christian. Then we might assume that nice people are godly people. But we'd be wrong. We'd be getting ahead of ourselves. If we assume that nice people are godly people, we would be making a mistake of forgetting the first lesson of all of this, the foundation, the cornerstone of our text here, that this is not about us, it's about God. One of the problems with church life is that we often equate politeness and niceness with Christian character. But it goes deeper than that. As we get further into the text, we start to hear that depth. We are told that we are not only to be humble and gentle, patient and bearing in love, but that we need to grow up. Verses 14 and 15 say, we must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ. So, we must not only be loving, we must be truthful. We must not only be truth tellers, but we must speak with love. I can think many times in my life when I was loving, but not truthful. And I can think of many times in my life when I was truthful, but not loving. Here are two rather extreme modern-day examples of this sort of behavior. They've evolved out of social media. The first is called ghosting, and the second is called shaming. Ghosting is an example of love without truth. It means completely cutting off all contact with somebody as a way of ending a relationship. In order to avoid the unpleasant and painful tasks of breaking up, a person will disappear completely. They unfriend the person on Facebook, they stop answering texts, emails, or phone calls without any reason or explanation. They disappear. They turn into a ghost. It's actually a pretty common practice, and people will justify it by saying that they didn't want to cause the other person the pain or embarrassment that comes with breaking up. Of course, this actually causes more pain in the long run. It's always better to go through a period of anger when a relationship ends than it is to be haunted by a ghost who didn't have the courage to face closure. Now, shaming is an example of truth without love. Recently, some of you may know, a dentist from Bloomington, Minnesota, went on a hunting trip in Africa and shot a beautiful and majestic lion. Well, it turns out the lion had been lured off of a protected area where he had been tracked for years by scientists from Oxford University. The lion had been named, and he was very well known. A picture of the hunter posing with the dead lion was posted on Facebook, and the man was harshly criticized for his crime. People reposted the picture along with their feelings of disgust at his act. It went viral. Soon the man was identified. The address of his place of business was posted. He was ridiculed on national TV. Protesters swarmed his office, shutting down his practice. Behind the protective wall of the internet, people began calling for his torture and death. Without the due process of law, the man was being prosecuted, sentenced, and punished through social media. It's certainly true that the man, knowingly or unknowingly, violated the rule of law and common decency. and those who express their disapproval were speaking truth. But it's equally clear that love was absent, and the response has descended into an internet feeding frenzy as violent and brutal as any hunt could be. Without God, love has no courage. Without God, truth loses all meaning. It's easy to see, in light of these examples, why the author of Ephesians begs his listeners to lead a life worthy of the calling to which they have been called. We need God's clear directive. We need to walk a narrow path, utilizing the gifts that we have been given, not to tear down or to destroy, but in order to preserve the unity of the Spirit. To embody both truth and love is a holy calling and a difficult task. But we do this neither by ourselves nor for ourselves. We do this as one, each of us knit together through the very ligaments of the body of Christ. So, as we go out into the world, guided by God's Spirit, we can strive towards two things. First, that we be humble, gentle, patient. And second, that we speak truth in love. Can you think of a person in your life who embodies these qualities? If so, take a moment and picture that person in your mind now. What do they do? What kinds of things do they say? How do they make you feel? If they're genuine, chances are you feel pretty good when they're around. Chances are your spirit lifts when they enter a room. You probably trust them more than the average person and seek out their wisdom and friendship. They are a light in the darkness. And with God's help, this is who we are becoming in Christ. Thanks be to God. Amen. Will you pray with me? Gracious God, we come to you this morning with the hope that your Spirit guides us. As we go forth from here, we ask that you be in front of us, that you show us the way and lead our understanding. We ask that you go behind us, that you encourage us and support us. We ask that you walk by our side through this valley of the shadow of death. And we ask that you live in our hearts, transforming us through the Spirit of your most holy Son. Amen.